glacial stratigraphy of Beaufort Margin sediments in the Arctic Ocean. This is a nice picture from when I was up there, sort of in the Arctic. And so the work I'm going to talk about today was published in Petroleum Science Reviews and Nature Geoscience. And I got to work with some awesome people for this project. Neil Driscoll, who's at Scripps, Lloyd Kegwin, me and Leepu were all at Wattola Oceanographic Institution, and Brendan Riley, who was at Oregon State University when we were doing this work. And it was funded by the National Science Foundation. So I studied the Beaufort Margin in the Arctic, and so here's a nice map of the Arctic. And this is the Western Arctic here, and this is the Beaufort Margin. So we spin around and zoom in. This is the Beaufort Margin, which is the Alaskan Canadian Arctic here. We have the Beaufort Sea. And so the Beaufort Margin encompasses Barrow Canyon, which is this canyon right here north of formerly known as Barrow, Alaska, which is the northernmost city in the United States. It's been renamed to its native name, which I cannot pronounce correctly. And that was something that's happened in the past year or so. And so the Beaufort Margin encompasses basically Bear Canyon through the Amundsen Gulf. And it's bifurcated by the Mackenzie River. This is the Mackenzie River trough. And so I'm going to be basically talking about primarily the Mackenzie River and this area right here. So why do we care about the Arctic? In the first place, it's really far away from most of us. Obviously, the Earth is warming, and the Arctic is warming at an incredibly fast rate compared to the globe on average, and also it's leading to a significant loss in sea ice. We're losing sea ice incredibly rapidly. Obviously, we're interested in the loss of sea ice and how fast it's shrinking because of Arctic amplification and how that just leads to more global warming and things like this. And so to study and kind of understand these times of rapidly changing climate, we want to look to the past, to other times of rapidly changing climate, just try and understand how the ocean, atmosphere, and climatic system all evolves in these different time periods. So I've been studying the Beaufort Margin basically during the last deglaciation, so the last glacial maximum to present, about the last 20,000 years, sort of the goal. And so this is a new static sea level curve going from LGM to present here. And we kind of had two goals in studying the Beaufort Margin. The first was I was interested primarily in looking at how did the margin evolve during the deglaciation. Primarily, what are the major factors controlling sediment distribution along the margins? A really large margin, we have a lot of various sediment inputs, and we have a lot of glacial controls there. There's some major sources of sediment, and these are primarily related to the Laurentide Ice Sheet that develops during the glacial periods. And so the Beaufort Margin was basically the northwestern extent of the Laurentide Ice Sheet. This map here, this is showing sea level lowered by 120 meters, approximately what it was during the last glacial maximum. And so this is the Mackenzie River right here for orientation. And so this is showing basically glacial extent. And during this, during the last glacial period, we had ice streams that were outlets for the northwestern Laurentide Ice Sheet. We had really prominent ice streams that developed in the Amundsen Gulf here, and this is the McClure Strait, and they had very significant ice streams. And then there was also an ice stream that developed in the Mackenzie Trough, but it was not as prominent, it wasn't always in existence, and it kind of had some fluctuations. And then as the Laurentide Ice Sheet retreated, during the deglaciation, it developed a series of glacial meltwater lakes, which is shown in gray here. And this map is showing the maximum extents of these glacial meltwater lakes. They didn't all exist at one time as the ice sheet retreated and you had different glacial isostatic adjustments. You started to develop different parts of these glacial meltwater lakes. And so these were some of the major sources of sediment going into the margin during that time. And then our other goal was to investigate the Younger Dryas cold period and freshwater input into the Arctic. And so the Younger Dryas was this slowdown in the rate of sea level rise in between meltwater coasts 1A and 1B. And what it really was this return to glacial-like conditions during the overall warming of the deglaciation. So we are going from this glacial period, atmospheric temperature. temperatures are warming, or ice sheets are melting. But then from about 12.9 to 11.7 thousand years ago, it all of a sudden started to get cold again, especially in Northern Europe. And so this is a plot of, in red, percent of polar foraminifera in a sediment core from the North Atlantic. And in green, we have air temperature over Greenland. And if we look at the percent of polar foraminifera, it's really high, and then it starts to go down. And all of a sudden, we have a spike in polar foraminifera, meaning that at this location in the North Atlantic, it started to get cold again, and we started to have these polar species start to occur there. If we look at air temperature over Greenland, it's getting warmer and warmer, and all of a sudden it gets cold again. And it's the same time period as that percent of polar foraminifera increased. Now this is some old data, and so this age is a little bit wrong due to some updates in radiocarbon calibration. But what we see is that during the Younger Dryas, it got colder in the oceans and in the atmosphere during this time period. And it's been proposed that this Younger Dryas cold period was caused by a massive freshwater input that actually slowed down North Atlantic deep water formation. And so what that would have been is freshwater going into making its way into the North Atlantic, where you form North Atlantic deep water, which is very, very cold, salty water, gets very dense and sinks, and it's likely one of the main drivers of thermohaline circulation. And if we add a lot of freshwater into this area, the water's not going to be as dense, not going to be sink as efficiently. You're going to get less heat moving its way over to Northern Europe, hence overall cooling conditions during that time. Now, where did this water come from? Well, as I mentioned, we have this series of glacial meltwater lakes that developed during the deglaciation as the Laurentide Ice Sheet melted. And Glacial Lake Agassiz was the largest one that developed. And so that is shown here in dark gray. And that was, the maximum extent of Glacial Lake Agassiz. And during its existence, meltwaters from Glacial Lake Agassiz drained to the oceans via different pathways. We had south down to down the Mississippi River, out into the Gulf of Mexico. We had multiple outlets that drained east, eventually making their way out the St. Lawrence. And then there's also a northwestern outlet that eventually waters made its way up to the Arctic via the Mackenzie River. What we're not quite sure of is which pathway these meltwaters took at the onset of the Younger Dryas to cause this climate period. And so for a long time, people thought it's primarily either the St. Lawrence or the Mackenzie. However, there's a lack of geomorphological evidence of Younger Dryas timing for either the southern or the eastern routes. And there's also a lack of what we call the smoking gun or a freshwater signal in planktonic foraminifera during the Younger Dryas timing. And so if we are looking for evidence of freshwater going into the oceans, we want to look at sediment cores from where that freshwater would be entering the ocean and looking at those surface dweller foraminifera to look for that freshwater signal. And so we wanted to investigate, was the Mackenzie the pathway these meltwaters took to the ocean? So we went to the Arctic to try and test this hypothesis. We went on a U.S. Coast Guard Cutter Healy in 2013, and we went along the Beaufort Margin from Barrow Canyon, primarily along the slope into the Amundsen Gulf, and then back again. And we collected a ton of high-resolution bathymetry and seismic reflection data, as well as a lot of jumbo piston cores, multi-cores, gravity cores, all the fun standard marine geology, geophysical things to investigate. And so, just for reference, I don't think I pointed this out before, these islands here, Big Island, this is Victoria Island, this whole area is called the Canadian Arctic Archipelago. Just for reference when I talk about that later. So here's some pictures of us collecting data. We initially were collecting toad chirp data off of the Healy. Eventually, we got into a lot of sea ice. 2013 was actually a surprisingly high sea ice year in the overall downward trend. And so we stopped towing the chirp when we were breaking through a lot of ice and started using the whole mounted Newton seismic reflection system. We did see polar bears, so I know you guys work in Antarctica. I don't get to see penguins, but lots of polar bears. They just, want to eat you. So it's a little bit different than seeing a penguin. So worth it. If you're not, magnetic susceptibility data is measured by a multi-sensor track, multi-sensor core logger, down core, and it's basically just the degree of magnetization of the material in the sediment core. And we sort of use it as a terrestrial tracer. We see higher magnetic susceptibility with terrestrial input, but it's just a really nice correlative tool that we use to kind of link a lot of our data sets together. And so this is what this looks like. This is showing magnetic susceptibility from a lot of our sediment cores going from Bay Arrow Canyon here all the way. We have our Mackenzie River trough right here, and then this is in the Amundsen Gulf. And this is kind of a good overall picture of what we sort of found. On the western part of the margin, sort of the primarily American part of the margin, we had a lot of Holocene sediment on the continental slope. And we had less on the continental slope on the eastern part of the margin, the more Canadian area. But we had a lot of deep glacial sediments deposited on the slopes that we were capturing in our sediment cores. So I'm just going to basically walk you through some seismic data and some sediment cores going along the margin here to sort of basically show you how we kind of got this overall picture. So this is a chert profile from west of Bay Arrow Canyon here, this little chert profile there. And this is a good picture of what we're seeing in this area, where we have this acoustically transparent sediment. Ignore these nice noise in the data. We had something, the ship had something on that was screwing with our signals. We had nice acoustically transparent sediment that was incredibly thick. And then we had really just thin layers of glacial diamicton here. And so in this area, we have a lot of Holocene sediment that's probably being funneled down Bay Arrow Canyon, coming from some of the Brooks Range and some of the areas here in Alaska. That's kind of primarily the drivers in this area for sediment. And then if we move and kind of swing along the margin here, now we're kind of halfway in between Bay Arrow Canyon and the Mackenzie Trough. This is a pretty representative chert profile of what we see there, where we still see kind of this nice, thick Holocene sediment over 10 meters thick. It's very acoustically transparent, really homogeneous material. But then we have these series of laminated deep glacial sediments here that are much higher amplitude. These sediments start to thicken towards the Mackenzie Trough and towards the ice streams. And so we think a lot of these sediments are coming out of the Mackenzie Trough and some of the Amundsen Gulf of Vancouver ice streams as well, and just making their way along the margin here. All right. And we have some nice evidence of some of this ice coming out of some of these ice streams here and flowing along the margin in this area. We look at some multi-beam data from there. Does that come across the best in the projector? But we have a bunch of iceberg scours basically going through our data. Some of these are kind of nice and wavy. It never comes great on the projectors. But we can see them going through this area and basically just showing evidence that we have a lot of icebergs flowing from the Amundsen Gulf areas going from east to west along the margin and leaving behind some of these nice glacial lineations. Now for kind of like probably some of the cooler part of the story or some of our major sediment inputs. I did a lot of high resolution grain size analysis on a lot of the sediment cores that we've collected. I'm just going to show you guys a couple today. And for this, I take a sample of the core every other centimeter throughout the entire core. And a lot of our sediment cores were 13 to 15 meters long. So this results in thousands upon thousands of samples. I run on a laser particle size analyzer. It's taken years of work. And I had one or two students help me a little bit, but I ran most of these myself. So you get to spend a lot of time in a little closet room and playing with mud and watching Netflix on my laptop. This is what it initially looks like. When you run one sample, you get a nice grain size distribution histogram. Where we have our highest volume of sediment going from smallest grain size here to the coarsest grain size, sort of our peak in the grain size distribution histogram. And this is what the plots look like for all the data that we're collecting. And basically, we're just going from the top of the core to the bottom, and we're just basically looking at having the peak kind of be up. You can imagine it's sort of like 3D where the peak is coming out of you, but the percent volume is in, shown in colors, and so green would be the peak here, and so this is showing very fine grain sediment with little variability because most of it's focused here, and then when we start to see these kind of bands like this, that's showing a coarser material in that sample. And so here we have a blue layer that's pretty far to the right, and so that's showing nice silty sand layer there. And so again, this is going from the top of the core to the bottom. And I'm showing you just between 0 and 200 microns, because overall these sediment cores were from the slope, and they were incredibly fine-grained. And when there's coarse material, it gets really, it's basically accounted for really nicely with this in this fine scale variability. Plotted on top of that, I have magnetic susceptibility from the core. And then I have the magnetic susceptibility plotted at scale on a seismic section from where the core was collected. And then from a couple of the cores, including this one, I have X-ray fluorescence data. And here I'm plotting the calcium-titanium ratio, which is primarily tracking the calcium signal. And then for a couple of the cores, including this one, we have some X-radiographs, which I'll go through then. But what does all of this data mean? So basically, we're looking at the top of this core. This is Jumbo Piston Core 36, and it's from the Mackenzie Trough right here. So that's where currently the modern Mackenzie River is, and where they used to have this ice stream flowing into the Arctic Ocean. And so this Jumbo Piston Core 36, the top of the sediment core is incredibly fine-grained with very little variability in grain size. The susceptibility data is pretty even. There's not too much variability. And that correlates with this more acoustically transparent section, the seismic data. And then we start to get down to the rest of this sediment core. We have a lot of these coarse layers overall. We can see a lot of variability in susceptibility data, a lot of these high amplitude reflectors. And when we basically see that same change at about 5 meters down in the core between this Holocene sediment and what we're calling the coarse layer unit. And that's because we have all these coarse layers. And if we look at X-radiographs from the core, if we look at the Holocene section right here at A, this is this X-radiograph, and there's no internal stratigraphy at all. It's just completely homogeneous, fine-grained material. We get farther down, here B, we have this really nice honking high amplitude reflector right here. And you can see these really, really bright bands that really get picked up by that X-radiograph there. See this really nice coarse layering. And then we get down to C, again, some of these layer deposits, we see the same thing. You can see some internal, much larger debris within those X-radiographs. And then right here, so that really coarse layer right there, that has a high percent volume coarse material, is actually this nice silty silty sand stringer right there in this photo. And in the photo, you can actually kind of see some of the color variation that's captured really nicely in these X-radiographs. Okay, so that's just so now, what do we think this is? Well, there's a sediment core collected by Shell et al. In 2008 from the same location that we collected our Jumbo Piston Core 36 in the Mackenzie Trough. And they have some age constraints from this unit. Basically, they capture the same stratigraphy where this coarse laminated unit as well. And based on their radiocarbon dates, we updated them using our age model. And it gives sedimentation rates of about 1,400 centimeters per thousand year, which is insane for the continental slope. That's showing that we clearly have some sort of major event deposit to be depositing that much sediment that rapidly on the continental slope. And so correlating those ages based on stratigraphy in our core. So now, where do we think that might have come from? Well, there was a study by Merck et al. In 2010. And we're going to go to 2010, where they documented two major erosive events onshore in kind of the Mackenzie, essentially pathway between Lake Agassiz and the Mackenzie, along the Mackenzie River. And they basically found these 30-meter high erosional terraces, huge gravel deposits on land that indicated major, major flood events. And so they dated these using luminescence data, and they dated one event, older event in between 13 and 11.7 thousand years ago, and they dated the younger event in between 11.7 and 9.3 thousand years ago. And based on these ages, from Schill and others, 2008, it potentially what we're looking at in this core slave unit is basically the offshore deposit of this younger erosive event that Mert and others saw onshore. So moving slightly east of the Mackenzie Trough, this is Jumbo Piston Cores 15 and 27. And we splice these two together because they're collected in the same location. And we splice them together to basically get an extended record. So what we see is a little bit different layers here. East of the Mackenzie Trough. We have our very similar Holocene material that's very fine grain. We have a little variability in our XRF, in our MET accessibility, more acoustically transparent signal there. And then we start to get some coarser grain size here, higher MET acceptability. We have this series of high amplitude reflectors here, a lot of spikes in the calcium titanium ratio. And we've been calling this our upper IRD unit. Because when you're in the Arctic and all of a sudden you see a lot of influx of coarse debris, you think maybe there's some sort of ice or some sort of freshwater bringing this to the location that we're looking at. And then we have this really large unit, which has, again, it's very fine-grained, and we have a little variability in any of these data sets again. And more acoustically transparent, we see kind of two sections. The lower section here, the older section, has a little bit higher amplitude on internal stratigraphy. And this is really fine grain. The average grain size is about 5 microns, which is just very, very, very fine grain material that we're seeing here. And then finally, at the bottom, we have this lower IRD unit. We start to see this nice spike, calcium titanium, coarser debris, this nice spike here in susceptibility, and it correlates with this very high amplitude reflector and seismic data. It's a really nice correlation between all these data sets. And so we have a lot of ages from these splice sediment cores. I'll show you again on the next slide. I'm going to show you some of this oxygen isotope data that we have from 4AMs from this these splice sediment cores. So I'm going to take this signal, the magnetic susceptibility signal, and basically just rotate it 90 degrees on its side. So here we're going from the top of the cores to the bottom. This is going from zero all the way down to our Holocene upper IRD unit. This is that green unit, which we call our fine scale layered unit. This is that lower IRD unit, that spike here. And so this is that magnetic susceptibility on top. Then we have Delta 018 in planktonic foraminifera. And which is our surface dwellers. Then we have Delta 018 and our benthic foraminifera, ones that live near the seafloor. And then we have sedimentation rates based on these calibrated radiocarbon ages here at the bottom. And so I'm going to start from the bottom and go up. And where we have that lower IRD layer, what we see is a lightening in the Delta 018 signal here. And that's indicative of freshwater input. And so we see this light signal in the planktonic foraminifera, and we don't see any lightning occurring in the benthic there. Then when we move farther up that core, we have this, not much variability going on, susceptibility data in this unit, not really anything exciting going on in the oxygen isotopes. But we get these crazy high sedimentation rates for this next unit. We actually got two radiocarbon dates where the C14 ages were the same, and the samples were from 2.5 meters apart in the sediment core. And so to get even these estimates of sedimentation rates of 1,700 centimeters per thousand years from this figure, we have to use kind of the sort of maximum kind of boundary ages or error ages to get these sedimentation rates. And so this is a lot of material that was deposited very rapidly. And then we have our upper IRD unit here. And what we see is that we have a freshwater signal or lightening in our planktonic foraminifera. And we see at the same time in our benthic foraminifera an also lightning signal. And so this indicates that we had fresh freshwater, basically going into our freshwater signals in the surface waters and near the seafloor, which indicates that we had some sort of major freshwater input that had a hypopycnal and a hyperpycnal signal. And so when we get a lot of these kind of, when you see freshwater in the surface waters, that means you just kind of have something at the surface where you could have, when you think about ice floating at the surface, that you get this freshwater signal here. But when you get this covariance with the benthic freshwater, it's more indicative of like a river flood where we have some of the fine-grained things going on the surface, but then you have some of the coarser debris going along the bedload, along the bottom, along the seafloor, that would get that freshwater signal in both of these signals. And so this actually started about 12.94 thousand years ago, based on our calibrated radiocarbon ages. And the Younger Dryas started about 12.9 thousand years ago. So we see this freshwater input just prior to the onset of the Younger Dryas. And so we see a really similar signal. I'm going to show you one more chord here before I kind of wrap up that story. This is Jumbo Piston Chord 25, and it's just from basically just east of the last cores that I was showing you. And we see really, really similar signals in the records from the sediment core, where we have our Holocene signal, very fine grain, little variability, acoustically transparent. But then we have not just our lower IRD unit, we actually see a middle IRD unit in the sediment core that's splitting up that fine grain, little variability unit into two. In all of these different signals here. We actually have X-radiographs from this sediment core, and so we can see what some of these units look like really nicely. This is A, which is from that upper IRD unit. And here we can see massive deposits of coarse debris within that upper IRD unit there. And then at B, this fine-grained little variability unit that was deposited incredibly rapidly has very, very faint laminae, very faint internal stratigraphy. And so that's why we've named this unit the fine-scale layered unit, because it's this layering is so much more faint and not as distinct as the coarse layered unit from the Mackenzie Trough. They are very, very different types of layering that we're observing here. And then we get down to that lower IRD unit, and you can still see all that layering, but you have a lot of coarse debris showing this influx, increasing all of these signals here. We also have ages that we've, from a sediment core nearby, from Scott and others in 2009, and we've correlated based on their magnetic susceptibility data, stratigraphy, and updated those ages using our age model. These different units here. So to kind of remind you, where do we think a lot of the sediment is coming from? Well, by starting around 15.6 thousand years ago, we started to have a significant retreat of the Mackenzie ice string here, and the Mackenzie ice lobe. And so this is showing basically extent of the Laurentide ice sheet through time, and so that nice rainbow scheme here as it's moving back and retreating. These black arrows are those ice streams. This is Amundsen ice stream, McClure, and Mackenzie right here. And as those the Laurentide ice sheet was retreating, we were developing these glacial meltwater lakes here. And so these are some of these major sources of sediment that we think deposited a lot of these layers that we see here. And so I'm gonna basically walk you through, because I just showed you a ton of data, and you didn't spend years of your life looking at it like I did. So it's not maybe the easiest thing to follow, so I'm gonna walk you through what we think those different sediment layers are and where we think they came from. And to correlate, here are those different glacial meltwater lakes, and this is representing our ice stream here, and the colors are coordinated between everything. So starting from the bottom, we have the deposition of our lower IRD unit here. This is a nice high amplitude signal. And this deposited about 14.6 thousand years ago. I think it was most likely ice rafting from the Amundsen, Bolt, and McClure ice streams coming out here and here and just making their way around the Beaufort margin. And then we had deposition of our fine scale layered unit, at least the first part of the section. And that was that where we had that really faint laminate, we had really, really high sedimentation rates. or 1,700 centimeters per thousand year there. And this was between 14.5 and 14.2 thousand years ago. And this is lately sourced from glacial lakes on Terra 2 and Travelland. Here, these kind of proglacial lakes onshore in the Mackenzie region, based on some of the onshore research that's been done, bringing a lot of this sediment to the margin. And then we have deposition of our middle IRD unit at that last core I just showed you, JPC 25. This is about 14.1 thousand years ago. And again, I think this was ice rafting from some of these ice streams on the San Mackenzie Strait. It was likely not as significant as sort of an ice release because we didn't see it at JPCs 15 and 27. So maybe just a smaller event and didn't make it as far around the margin. And then we had deposition of the second part of our fine skill layers unit about 14 to 13,000 years ago. I think this was sediment that was from the glacial lakes Mackenzie, McConnell, and Peace. And so different parts of these lake systems here. Again, these are the maximum extents of these lakes, so not all of this was in existence at one time. And then we had the deposition of our upper IRD unit about 12.94 to 12.23 thousand years ago. I think this was glacial lake Agassiz drainage through the Mackenzie McConnell system. So we could have a combination of freshwater discharge from these series of lakes into the ocean. And so if you recall when I talked about that onshore event, those two onshore floods documented by Burton and others in 2010, they documented two floods, and their older flood they dated between 13 and 11.7 thousand years ago. And this upper IRD unit was deposited during that same time interval. And so we're probably seeing the offshore extent of the event that they saw, they documented onshore. And again, this coincides basically with the onset of the Younger Dryas cold period. And then finally, we had deposition of the coarse layered unit focused in Mackenzie Trough about 11.3 to 10.6 thousand years ago. And we think that, again, this is more drainage from glacial lake Agassiz through the Mackenzie-McConnell system out into the Arctic. And also, this falls within the Younger time interval for the flood observed onshore by Martin et others in 2010. And it's actually around the time of the what was called the pre-boreal oscillation event. And this was another short-lived cold period, a couple hundred years after the end of the Younger Dryas. And so potentially, this freshwater drainage into the Arctic also causes other kind of smaller scale or more short-lived freshwater drainage event. So I'm just going to show you one more kind of core and a little bit of a separate story in Amundsen Gulf real quick. And so this is JPC 19 from the Amundsen Gulf. And what we see here is quite different from the last kind of set of cores that we looked at. Primarily, when we were looking at our grain size, we would see typically an increase in grain size would coincide with an increase in magnetic susceptibility. Here, this unit right here doesn't see a significant increase in grain size, but we have really, really high magnetic susceptibility here. Also, when we see high magnetic susceptibility, we typically observe a high amplitude reflector in the seismic data. And this, again, is the opposite. It's much more acoustically transparent, not really high amplitude at all, where this high susceptibility is. And so it's very usually indicative of some sort of different sediment source, kind of very different characteristics than we've been looking at so far. Below that, we have a lot more variability in grain size, and some variability in magnetic susceptibility data, and we have a lot of variability in these kind of high amplitude series of reflectors here. And so if we look at a bunch of seismic profiles here from around JPC 19, if we look at them in perspective in what we call a fence diagram, we can see that this area was where you had your Amundsen Gulf ice stream flowing over, and it actually created a nice drumlin field here, we can observe. And then there's this nice basin where you had deposition a lot of glacial marine sediments, which are what those nice layered sediments are. And this is where JPC 19 is located. And here we can see, this is some multibeam data from McLean and others 2015, so we can see what this drumlin field looks like really nicely from the movement of that ice stream over that area. Now if we look at that high magnetic susceptibility unit, here. It actually thickens here towards the southwest, which is this kind of corner right here. Instead of, we think most of our sediment would kind of be going in and out of the Amundsen Gulf, but this unit thickens away from this area to the southwest. Well, Batchelor and others in 2014 mapped a bunch of glacial till sheets from the Amundsen Gulf, or in the Amundsen Gulf, and basically they found about 8 till sheets, and most of them were from advances of the Amundsen Gulf ice stream, but the youngest till sheet they actually attributed to the Anderson ice stream. And so the Anderson ice stream is right here, and it basically ends sort of in the farthest western part of the Amundsen Gulf. And what this is basically, it's what's called an ephemeral ice stream, that as the Laurentide ice sheet was retreating, you start to have a reorganization of the ice dynamics and where the ice is flowing out into the ocean. And so an ephemeral ice sheet develops in those instances. And so the Amundsen, or the Anderson ice stream, is thought to be this ephemeral ice stream that developed as the ice sheet was retreating, depositing this last glacial till sheet. And so the fact that we see a very different type of signal, this high susceptibility data, low grain size, and it's thickening to this area, indicates that we have the source of the sediment is something different. It actually is that Anderson ice stream. So I could go on. I have 1,000 more cores, not 1,000, but I have a lot more cores and a lot more data, but I wouldn't bore you too much. If you're interested, you can come up with the papers or talk to me after. But in conclusion, we pretty much see on the western part of the Beaufort Margin that we have really thick Holocene sediment, this nice acoustically transparent sediment, that overlies coarser laminated deglacial sediments that are from Mackenzie drainage and the Amundsen-McClure ice streams. We also see that the Mackenzie Trough and the Eastern Margin are really dominated by event deposits, including ice shafting and meltwater drainage events. We see that the proximal proglacial lakes likely delivered a lot of the fine layered sediments that we observe on the margin. And we see 2 major floods that align with the Merton and others events that they observed onshore. One was at the onset of Younger Dryas that brought coarse debris. It has a freshwater signal, and then there was one at the onset of the pre-boreal oscillation event that deposited incredibly coarse layered sediments focused in the Mackenzie Trough. And then finally, the Amundsen Gulf is not really a surprise, but it's really dominated by glacial-related erosion and deposition since the LGM. And so